Thank you very much. Thank you for your presentation and introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, I understand that it's the last presentation, and maybe better that this presentation will be not so speculative and argumentative, but more historical, descriptive, and maybe narrative. Last year, casually, I found this figure, Michael Saravecius de Petra Sancta, and evidently he was, for unknown reasons at the moment, really forgotten. However, all his philosophical treatises were printed in Rome or in Perugia. Now I am preparing, I finished the critical edition of his treatise De Analogia Contra Scotistas. I prepare his short but documented biography. And I take this occasion not so for condivide with you his argumentation, because my more historical presentation is an invitation for the reading of the future publication of critical edition will be next year in the journal Angelicum. Do you have my handouts? And to this handout correspond my slides presentation. Look at it. Therefore, we are between the 15th and 16th century, geographically in Italy, but in Italy divided in many, many small states. Something about his origin. Michael Saravecius, Michael da Seravezza, sometimes Saravezza or Saravezza. It's normal in Asian names, these differences. Born, according my research, around 1475. Saravezza is at very small town, I say, near Pietra Sancta, in province of Lucca in Toscana today, but in his time it was part of Republic of Genoa and later of the Republic of Florence and successively Duchy of Toscana. He was son of certain Francesco Cupini. It's evident from different indexes in Italian convents. Michael from Saravezza, near Pietra Sancta, or Petra Sancta, and his father was Francesco Cupini. To have an idea about these territories, I prepared maps for Republic of Genoa and northwest of Italy. It's one of Asian pictures of Saravezza to have an idea about the nature and style of this place. Toscana, mounts, etc. Pietra Sancta, the second more important town in this zona. And now we know that he entered the Dominican order in Savona, Pietra Sancta, Savona, convent San Domenico, maybe in 1490. It's not so easy to say what province or affiliation was convent of Savona, because in this period, in the territory, in Italian territory, were many provinces and different congregation, and we know that his convent was reformed by Blessed Albert della Chiesa in the 15th century. Therefore, it was a movement of observance, maybe congregation of Lombardy, It's possible that it was Savonarolian congregation of San Marco. Another information we have on him that this convent of Savona was, for example, in this period famous for the work, teaching, and presence of Silvestro Mazzoli da Priero, and evidently he will be his teacher, master in Bologna, successively arrived the future Pius V as professor of logic or metaphysics in this convent. Bologna. From Bologna, we have incredible authentical testimony of his presence because his colleague, another Dominican student, very well known Leandro Alberti, historian of the Dominican order, mentioned during his life in his book De Illustribus Ordinis Predicatorum, that in 1491, 1493, 1495, both Leandro and Saravecius were present in Bologna with Silvestro Mazzolini da Prierio. He is one of Renaissance very well known, I think, scholars. He published a very controversial dialectic, Apology of this Dialectic, Commentary on Sentences. Successively, he beginning Master of Holy Palace, and he died during sack of Rome. Would be another occasion to mention a recent book of Michael Tavuzzi. It's a monography only on Prierias with very precise documentation. After his studies in Bologna, we have some very short information about his presence in convents as Prato, Lucca, Florence, but Florence San Marco at the beginning of the 16th century. And finally, in 1509, he received an approbation for preaching and hearing confessions in the Roman province. It's very probably that in this period he beginning really affiliated in immediately a convent, probably Lucca San Romano in the Roman province. Maybe he lost the preceding congregation because this period was extremely complicated. After the execution of Savonarola, his congregation of San Marco was incorporated in Roman province with some autonomy. And maybe that for him, according different documents, would be a bit comfortable and reasonable to be fully member of this province mediately an affiliation of San Romano in Lucca or something similar. Intentionally, I chose really historical pictures of these cities because contemporary photos are very, very different, but they are more or less authentical pictures of these cities. From this period, precisely 1509, we have a completely singular document. Thomas de Vio, the future Cardinal Gadgetan, Thomas de Vio of Gaeta, published his commentary on Aristotelian's De Anima. And look at it, he asked a recommendation for this work by Saravecius. Therefore, the first letter in this edition, it is a recommendation of Michael Saravecius of Petra Sancta, that interesting book commentary Thomas de Vio, etc., etc. It is their only bibliographical indication, the date, place, the precise title, and now it's full letter. It's short, but the first letter and recommendation of this, evidently, Gadgetan asked it. It will would be impossible that another philosopher insert in his book this recommendation during his life. It's a bit paradoxal because Gadgetan in this moment had a supreme position in the Dominican order. He was the general master of the order. Saravecius was only lecturer. He was not master of sacred theology in this moment. Therefore, not ordinary professor like today, but a teacher of philosophy in different convents, lector, lecturer. After this event, he is evidently present in the convent of his affiliation, because in this period affiliation was directly, immediately a convent, not by province. Therefore, between 15 and 9 to 15 and 13, he is present according Book of Conventual Councils in Convent San Romano in Lucca, and in Perugia too sometimes, but Lucca was his own convent. Particularly interesting is his stay in Rome. Now, Santa Maria sopra Minerva. And what happened in Rome with him, his teaching, etc. In 1550, he was appointed by the general chapter. It's important, not by a papal bull or immediately another friendship in Curia Romana or Curia Generalicia, but really immediately general chapter in Naples. He was, I say very correctly, transparently appointed master in sacred theology. It's equivalent to doctorate in theology and supreme academical degrees in the order, as the son of Roman province. Therefore, during this period, he really accepted his incardination or affiliation immediately San Romano or Minerva, but evidently from the Roman province. At the same moment, precisely 1 year after, we have many independent documents about his academical activities in Rome. It says that he was regent of the Dominican Studium in Rome at Minerva. It's not exactly the same thing like the future Angelicum, because this institution, Collegium Divi Tome, was founded in the century, but 50 years after, by Juan Solano. In this moment, it is really a studium of the Roman province, but he is appointed as director regent of this institution 1 year after his promotion as master in sacred theology. But the second information is more interesting and unusual. We know not only immediately different Dominican philosophers and writers, etc., but immediately university documentation, La Sapienza, that about 15 and 16, he was professor of metaphysics at the Roman University La Sapienza. Why it's unusual? Because it was not a Dominican institution. It was an autonomous university founded by the Pope. It's shortly history of Sapienza, by the Pope, immediately Roman Senate. And in this period was a period of, revision and reform of this university. Arrived other faculties, medicine, canon law, civil law, philosophy, etc. But I am not sure, according to the conserved documents, if he was professor of metaphysics at the Faculty of Philosophy of Arts or Faculty of Theology. Because in this period, many of faculties of theology conserved courses of metaphysics. Metaphysics was presented at the Faculty of Philosophy only for the last cycle for doctoral studies, not for inferior courses. Therefore, it's possible that his teaching was at the Faculty of Theology or Philosophy, but it's not so probable, I think. Successively, Dominicans had for some centuries reserved places at this university, for example, for physics. Cathedra of natural philosophy was, according to status, reserved only for Dominicans, etc. But in generally, Dominican presence is documented, but it was not a Dominican institution, and Dominican presence is ordinarily, but relatively rare, not so common. But we are sure that Saravecius in 15, 16, 17, maybe, was present. And in this period exactly, he published the bigger part, the major part of his philosophical treatises. Parallelly, we have some letters from 15 and 17, 18 that he was interested in Lutheran reform. It's not so surprising because Mazzoleni Prierias was the first, before Cardinal Gadgetan, appointed by the Pope to resolve the question of this Augustinian monk, Martin Luther, and Prierias was the first in 1517 to publish an answer to him. Carissime Frater Martine, etc. And his opinion was that it does not matter, he is an Augustinian monk, and we have many other more important things that discuss with a German Augustinian about not so intelligent questions. But Saravecius himself was a bit co-involved in this problem or in this discussion. Next year, or 2 years after, he is present in the territory of his province, now in Florence, Santa Maria Novella, and he received a special permission for the foundation and construction of the church and hospice St. Vincent Ferrer in Pietra Sancta, near Saravecia. He was authorized by the Bishop of Lucca and Dominican authorities to be responsible for the construction of this religious house, hospice. The last document, it's a letter which was published of his presence in Rome, but at Santa Maria Sopra Minerva, is dated in 12th of July, 1521. It is the last document from his life and presence in Rome. After this date, for today, I never found any other documentation. Well, it's possible that he died naturally, or it's possible that he was killed during the sack of Rome about 6th of May in 1527, as his teacher Mazzoleni Prierias. Do you know that in this history of Roman University I mentioned that a numerous group of some of the professors have been killed and students too during this invasion and violent occupation of Eternal City. Now something about his really academical activities. On this slide we have published works of Michael Saravecius. The first exactly it is on topic Questio de analogia entis contra Scotistas. I presented it shortly but in some details. Published in Perugia in 1516 in the same volume with Questio de universalibus, Tractatus de prima et secunda intentione. In a parenthesis, I prepare a critical edition of prima et secunda intentione to maybe be published successively after Analogia Entis, because I observe his order of titles and treatises. Next year, Questio de causalitate, primi principi de mente philosophiae et averroes in Romano Gymnasio, it says Sapienza in this period, disputata contra averroistas nostri temporis. In the same volume, Questio de principio individuationis contra Scotistas, disputata ibidem. And finally, Questio de subjecto philosophiae naturalis contra Scotistas. Some years after, but we are not sure if, number seven, it is with his letter and last really document of his presence at Minerva, Libellus de defensione astrologorum judicantium exconjunctionibus planctarum depicibus ani in 1524. It's on meteorology and prevision of different changement in water and in rivers, etc. With a letter, Saravecius' letter with the date 12 of June 1521, but the second title, De Vera Diluvi Prognosticatione, published in Rome in 22, it's not so sure if Saravecius was really in life. Another complication is that this book is conserved only in one exemplar in Apostolic Library in Vatican, and but both topics, number 7 and 8, are not strictly philosophical but merely meteorological. This picture or this photo, it is only an example of the style of typography and typographical level of his publication. Another thing, it is bibliography on him but relatively poor and short. The most important, it is exactly authentical testimony on him by Leandro Alberti de Viris Illustribus Ordinis Predicatorum. It's a precise indication, you can control it. Famous Cetif Eschar Scriptores Ordinis, from them we know the name Savona of his vestition in the Dominican order, Thomas Dempster, De Etruria Regali, but it is a copy of information from Cetif Eschar, Carafa Josephus, De Gymnasio Romano et De Eius Professoribus. Yeah, there are two books on the history of Roman University. Maybe that partially they are independent information about, for example, succession, who was before him, who was after, as professor of metaphysics. And now different documents of the order of Curia Generalitia, Registro di Sebastiano Bontempi, and eventually Epistolario di Fra Vincenzo Mainrandi da San Gimignano. They are different letters, indexes, list of brothers, Dominican brothers in different convents, etc. It's true that his name and his books were mentioned by different Spanish, German in 18th century to Polish, Italian authors, but without any other new information, only the fact that Thomas Saravecius published treatise De Analogia, eventually that he was professor at Sapientia. Now, at the last part of this presentation, I can mention some particularities or interesting aspects of this treatise. According his declaration in the preface of this book, the text was written in 1514. It says 1 year before his promotion as master of sacred theology, and compound at the convent Santa Maria sopra Minerva, and 2 years after published in Perugia. We don't know why, maybe an economical question, why in Perugia and not in Rome, maybe question of censure of master of sacred palace, because all books, in not only in this period, but to 20th century, at least religious book, after the unification of Italy, but during many centuries, all book published in Rome must be approved by the master of sacred palace. Well, therefore, in Perugia, the treatise is dedicated to Cardinal Niccolò Fieschi. Maybe that today his name is not so known, like name of other cardinals of this period, but he was protector of the Dominican order. He was an Italian cardinal of the very, very prominent family of Republic of Genoa. Bishop of Fergus from Edge, Archbishop of Ravenna, and many, many episcopal titles. Very power man, I say. The second letter, or the second text, it is an introductory letter of Volumino Campelli da Spoleto. This family, Campelli, was another very powerful families in Italy, particularly in Spoleto. But more important is the fact that Volumino was before him appointed as professor of metaphysics, maybe a secular priest or layman. And his recommended this book to Bartolomeo Pinginucci da Pietra Sancta, a judge auditor of the Roman Rota. Well, the treatise is relatively short, 23 pages, representing teaching at the University La Sapienza in Rome at the beginning of 16th century. I could only add that for us, for history of scholastic or Thomism or many other similar scholastic topics, it's interesting that we have a printed version of a lecture presented at the University La Sapienza. It says we can observe, we can reflect on the style, level, arguments, knowledge of different authors, etc. According this perspective, it is very precious document, very authentical about the level of Dominican professors, maybe another professors too, at the Roman University in this period. And another thing which I found very interesting, or I consider interesting, it is the fact that it's not a Dominican house of studies. It says that at the moment that he presented an argument, for example, or analogy against Cotistas, etc., he must be very, very sure and strong in his argumentation, because this presentation was in an ambient where the major part is against him for different reasons, because nominalistas, because Cotistas, etc. It's similar like the case of Paolo Soncino in my book on his metaphysics. We are in a very different academical ambient that in the 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th, 20th century. It's an open, absolutely mixed, not confessional according to the school, university, and, for example, promotions to be doctor or to in the presentation of an argument like this, it is in an aula, it is in a community when at least the half or major part are against him or were against him. It's an interesting aspect because a big part of successive treaties are presented by Thomists for the Thomists. Another question or another chapter would be the list of names who were his Scotists. Well, the bigger part or the major part is very well known, like Dr. Subtilis himself. Only one non-Franciscan, John Canonicus, Johannes Mambre Canonicus, a Spanish thinker of the 14th century, secular priest, canon, Franciscus Meironius. This name is interesting. Antonius Sirectus. Antonius Sirectus was his contemporary. A bit old generation, but evidently from his period. And Saravecius, not only that he quoted him, his formalitates, but please look at the list of the reedition in this period. It says that maybe this Franciscan doctor, Antonius Sirectus, today, I'm not sure, maybe you know him. According to my impression, he is a bit forgotten, but look at this frequency of reeditions of his book. He must be very, very influential. And could you imagine the price of a book in this period printed? And 84, 85, 89, they are continuous reedition of his book, not after. And evidently not before, but during this period, he is evidently very asked and popular Scotist. Antonius André, very well known, Antonius Trombetta, contemporary author. He was a living author during the publication of this treatise. And Franciscus Sansonis. Franciscus Sansonis Nani, another Franciscan contemporary of Saravecius, and his commentary on physics. Well, he is mentioned sometimes, but I think that his book had not so success like publication of Sirectus. This picture, it is a very rare, extremely rare, maybe unique Pantheon gallery of Scottish scholars in the Franciscan convent in Brixen, today in Italy. Well, it's not a moment to present precisely his arguments. It is, I repeat, it is an invitation to reading of this arriving critical edition, but only some aspects of the structure of this book, of this treatise. The first step, he clarify what is univocity, equivocity, and analogy. he proceed according a relatively very different way regarding Cardinal Gadgeta. Thomas de Vio was not cardinal in this period, okay, but Thomas de Vio in this period, he published his treatise in 90s, 94, 96. He published De Nominum Analogia, 97, maybe in 90s, it says 15 years before him. And but Saravecius presented as an introduction of this of this problem Aristotle's categories, Averroes commentary on it, on categories, some argument for Al-Ghazali, and finally explanation of univocity, equivocity of Aquinas, but not according sentences, but according his commentary on metaphysics and de potentia and summa theologiae. The second step, it is, I say, very precise quotation of different Scottish texts. I admire the fact that Saravecius quoted fully, precisely, not only according Trombetta said. No, he said question, title, and quoted him, and finished quotation, Hec istius, etc. Therefore, we have text, we can observe, for example, textual variation, if they are quoted correctly or not, and very precise, and if you remember this list of his victims, he was well informed about the situation in Scottish school. And conclusion, it is an answer, his personal answer to every one of them, and a Thomistic conclusion. According my impression during the preparation of critical edition is that his idea is primarily make evident that however Scotists accept authority of Aristotle, Averroes, etc., their interpretation is not correct or not conformable with these authors. It is his first, I say, very important argument. It says, however you Scottish accept Aristotle and Averroes, evidently his arguments are completely against your conclusions. Therefore, you cannot accept these authors, or you must accept their conclusions, because your interpretations is evidently against the text, against the letter, against the idea of the author. And many other arguments. And another interesting aspect of this argumentation, like Aquarius, Saravecius openly accepted analogy of being for of attribution and proportionality, and not only for the real being, God, substance, accidents, but for real being and being of reason too. And not only attribution, well, Aquinas himself accepted it, presented it in his commentary on metaphysics, but Saravecius, and I have some doubt about it, if it is or not correct, really he presented analogy of proportionality and not metaphorical for the concept of being of reason and real being. For me, at least for me, it's a surprising and interesting position. I think that it's very, very difficult to defend it. Last part, well, at the time I respected it, it's only an illustration of the structure and typographical disposition indication of different arguments, names and quotations, and the text is typical for it's a paleo tip after 15 and 1, but style is as incunable, perfectly comparable. The last slide, it is, if you want, it is exactly a part of my future critical editions. I beg your pardon for eventual mistakes confusions, but I hope that this part is correct. If you have an idea about his style or proceeding, it is exactly the paragraph when he proceed from interpretation of Aristotle to some objections of Antonius Andreas, and maybe not only Andreas, but it is a paragraph where his peripatetical's argument and Scottish argument would be resolved. It's only one of paragraph, but to have a concrete idea about his style and argumentation, I insert this illustrative slide for it. Well, thank you very much for your attention, and I invite you for the reading of the critical edition of this author.